Thanks for your cooperation.
Tell her more surgery done, but now there's only one other thing. And that's one of the long time consuming stages, a forensic stage.
Yay! Hello, Mr. Butterfly, I'm Alyssa.
Toy. She's still examining corpses, old corpses.
Great. She's at it again. Hey, kitty girl, what are you doing? No trespassing.
Oh, miss! Chloe's better!
Chloe? Who are you talking about?
Chloe's the kitty you helped. Now she comes over to play.
Glad to hear it. In any case, you're not allowed here.
Hey, miss, what's your name?
Me? Oh, I'm Naomi. Naomi Kimishima.
Okay. Hi, Naomi. I'm Alyssa. I live just on the other side of the garden here.
I see. That makes us neighbors.
Yep, so I can come see you anytime I want.
She lives in the research building?
Now, Alyssa, this is a place where most people can't go. That's why I need you to...
Oh, and who's this little princess? Am I intruding?
Chief.
Hello, mister. I'm Alyssa.
Hello, Alyssa. I'm David. Excuse me, but can I borrow Naomi for just a moment?
Okay. Naomi's got work to do, right? I'll be going then. Bye-bye, Naomi. See you later.
It seems you've made a cute little friend.
You know she doesn't have any security clearance, right?
Now, you think I'm that uptight? It's not like we're using diamonds to decorate the garden.
Anyway, you're here to talk about work, correct? I'm listening.
Yes, a few hours ago, a body was found in Oxford. The FBI's requesting that we send you to investigate it.
Me? Is there some crime involved?
It's our job to determine that. What do you say?
This is my duty, isn't it? I'm on it. The victim lived in a cottage in Oxford with her husband. The husband called the police, saying he had killed her. When they arrived, she was on the floor with a chest wound.
All right, pretend you can feel the vibrating remote. And pretend you can hear that clearly.
Accept. The FBI thinks the husband may not be telling the truth. All right. Let's discover how this tragedy played out. Tell me the facts.
All right. Get a dead 75-year-old. And the husband says that he was guilty. Still gonna look into this though.
Her husband Joseph called the police late last night. On arrival, they found her body, stabbed in the chest. The husband was in a wheelchair, holding a bloody knife. Joseph's account is that they had a fight that escalated.
A man in a wheelchair stabbed someone who could walk?
That's what he says happened.
Okay, wait, do I have images turned off or... No, I don't think so. Yeah, because I saw one earlier.
Find out what you can about the murder. I'll check the body.
Right, please get started.
The dead tell no tales, and if they do, nobody listens. Only the dead who haven't died yet can discover the truth.
What?
Let's begin. Show me how your light was put out.
So the living who are no longer alive. Well, here are the people. Apparently, elderly Bob is the guy who says he killed this old woman. Who was his wife? He can't walk due to thrombi in his veins. It's not really white hair, it's more like a wheatish color. Oh, let's see. Do we have any evidence in the evidence room? Yeah, we do. Alright. Let's see what the matter is with the body here. Well, we got red X's. Stabbing. Stabbing wound.
The weapon's cross section must be.
Cross shaped or star shaped? Well, you could argue that that's kind of star shaped, I guess. The answer they're looking for is cross-shaped.
Right. The weapon must be shaped like a cross.
So she was killed by Jason Todd, clearly.
And killed the victim. What kind of weapon has a shape like that?
A screwdriver? A giant screwdriver? Oh boy. Also, stars on the side of the head.
It's star-shaped?
Apparently that's a wound, though. The shape of the weapon.
Yes, we can figure out the shape of the weapon that inflicted them. Still, a star-shaped bruise. What kind of weapon would leave that?
A star-shaped pattern, too. Well, oh yeah, the also an exit wound.
This stab wound is small, but it's rather deep. There's a wound with a similar shape, but it's a different size.
And also apparently something in the back of the hands here. Jesus, what is this?
What could this be?
Looks like the mystery bruise is back.
I've never seen a bruise like this. Is it something congenital?
What about this?
This is internal bleeding.
Internal bleeding.
Caused by something pressing against the palm.
Well, it's easy to make out, I guess, when the rest of this skin has turned.
A great deal of force to leave this mark on the victim.
Has turned the color of water. Chlorinated water. I guess that's all we're gonna learn from the body, though. There's nothing in the front of the hands. And nothing on the other side of the head. Well, what about the personal effects? We got giant bloodstain and stab wound and some hairs.
What's this? Is it hair? That's bizarre because
it's obviously artificial. Well, maybe not obviously, but it doesn't match the hair color, I guess. Where is that?
Indeed. The victim and the suspect reportedly both have white hair. I need to send this in for analysis and identification.
So we're gonna harvest some hairs so we can figure out where they came from. There's the exit wound again. And apparently nothing else. Well, there's also a wound here. Let's see.
Blood stains on the left sleeve. Was there a wound on the corpse's arm? It could be the murderer's blood. This needs to be investigated further.
More blood, but apparently not caused by a wound to the corpse itself. So let's go and give these people stuff to do. What are these hairs?
Hey, little guy, could you analyze this hair?
Yes, of course. Dr. Kimishima, this isn't human hair. It seems to be from some sort of animal.
You know, they're called pets. And no, there weren't any signs that they had any.
Strange. Still, this is obviously not human hair. I can see cuticles, so this isn't synthetic hair or a fiber.
All right. Can you identify what animal it's from?
Yes, that's me. You haven't been watching this particular game, have you, Lambda?
No, that's beyond my expertise.
This is like the third super detective case we're gonna solve with this interface.
But I do see something odd about it.
Go on.
Well, the hair has a tip, but the other end doesn't have a root.
No root? That means...
The hair was cut.
So the hair had been cut.
Right. This means that the hair didn't fall off the animal naturally.
Why would something like this be on the corpse?
Well, we find out what the hair was. Apparently it's animal fur. Do we know what this blood is?
Mishima, do you need an analysis?
Well, I'm not here to ask you out on a date. Just look at these.
Are these bloodstains?
Yes, they were on the victim's left sleeve.
That's odd. This blood isn't the victim's.
What do you mean?
Well, the results say that only the H-type antigen was detected in this blood. That makes this blood type O.
The victim has type A blood. What about her husband? He's a suspect.
He has type O. Does this mark him as the culprit after all?
Let's not start jumping to conclusions. First, let's check to see if the husband is injured. If this blood came from him, he must be wounded.
All right. Do we know anything about the internal bleeding? I guess we don't. What about the black bruise? Don't know anything about the mystery bruise. The star-shaped bruise? I guess we would have to find a weapon. Murder weapon? No. Giant gaping gashes on chest and back. Well, we know that the murder weapon doesn't really match that chest wound.
These stab wounds are different sizes, but they have the same shape. We can deduce that these wounds are connected by...
You know, the weapon?
Yes. These two wounds were caused by the same strike, piercing all the way through her body. If that's the case, the entry wound was...
More chest.
Indeed. If something is pierced all the way through by a sharp implement, the entry wound must be at least as large as the exit wound. If these wounds were caused by the same strike, it would have to be 20 centimeters or longer. This isn't enough to identify a weapon, but it does get us one step closer.
Well, guess we're not gonna discuss the, you know, shape of the wound versus the shape of the knife, though. Murder weapon length. Can we collate these two? No, apparently not. Can we collate the bruises on the hands? No. Do we just back out of this? No. We need to figure this.
Little guy, can we determine the shape of this weapon?
I think so, yes. I'll need some information, though. What can you tell me? How big is it?
Well, it's at least...
At least 20 centimeters is what we just said. Guess we just need to...
It's shaped like a...
Need to remember that, like a cross.
A cross shape. Does that help?
Yes, thank you. We'll have the results in a moment. I see. This isn't a cutting tool, like a knife. It's like a spike or a spear. Something meant for piercing.
So, a stabbing weapon. I don't like the looks of this.
Right. This isn't your usual murder weapon.
That's right, someone got stabbed with a spear, it seems. Guess that would pretty much mean that the murder weapon we were given is a fake.
You mean the weapon in the shape of the wound, right?
That knife isn't long enough to have done that. And it's nowhere close to the right shape. No, something else has to be the real murder weapon. The second thing this tells us is...
But he said that the knife was a murder weapon, so he's lying. That much we know. Apparently the fact that he's lying is solid evidence, though.
I agree. The husband's definitely lying to us about something. In any case, we know for sure that the knife isn't the murder weapon. However, we still don't have a clue what the real weapon was, or who the killer is.
Take it easy. We just have to think about all of this. A sharp weapon, like a spear, that can go through a human body. We'll have to find out what it was.
Well, I think we can do much more right now, though.
Dr. Kimishima, we're done interrogating Joseph.
Joseph? You mean the victim's husband who confessed to the murder?
Yes, he just keeps saying that he killed her. We've got nothing to go on.
I'd like to hear the recordings myself anyway. I want to know if the blood on the victim's sleeve was his or not.
I've already sent you the data. You can examine it whenever you want.
Yes, I'll do that. Thank you.
All right, I got two topics to, or just one topic to look into with this recording.
I've already told you people, it was a domestic dispute. I was angry at my wife and I stabbed her. That's all there is to it. So what if I'm in a wheelchair? It doesn't mean I can't stab someone. She was standing right in front of me, so I just shanked her right there. I turned myself into the police right after. You know what happened after that. But what about my hand? I injured it, that's all. How I injured it has nothing to do with this. I accidentally cut myself while I was stabbing her. I know, stupid, right?
12.
I've already told...
Apparently he cut himself. And his hand was injured.
I see. The victim's husband does have an injury on his hand. This will prove that the bloodstains came from the husband.
So we know that we got bloodstains that came from the husband. Guess we're gonna collate that with the blood on the shirt.
These pieces of information do share a common bond. The blood on the victim's sleeve is type O. Joseph has a wound on his right hand, and he himself has type O blood. There's little doubt that the bloodstains on the sleeve were left by him. That doesn't prove that he killed Alma, though. We'll need more evidence to be certain. Let's keep investigating.
Yep, that's totally me, you know. Even though I'm from, like, Mesoamerican heritage, I have super pale skin and blonde hair and blue eyes like that. I am the model of Aryan perfection. No, I'm not. Also, I totally missed that was said, but...
There's so much about it that's hard to believe.
You don't think the husband did it, Dr. Kimishima?
Who knows? Anyway, let's put the facts we know so far in order. The reason why it's doubtful that the victim's husband is the murderer is because...
If Joseph is a killer, then why... Would he hide the real murder weapon? Guess he could still stab with his injured hand.
The knife he said he used could not have caused the wounds she died of. There are other reasons to doubt him too, no matter what weapon he used. Pushing it all the way through a human body would require a lot of strength, but he's...
I guess he couldn't because he can't stand. He's got the rest of his lower body between his hands and the...
He is wheelchair bound and cannot stand under his own strength. Would he be able to kill someone like this while sitting in a wheelchair?
Well, have you heard of jousting?
His hospital records make it clear that he can't stand up at all.
Yes. The shape of the weapon and the details of the death make it unlikely that he's the murderer. Still, he insists that he's the one who killed her.
I don't get it. Usually people lie to avoid being blamed for a crime.
Huh. You have a lot of experience with lying, Mr. Investigator?
Hey, we agreed not to bring up the past, didn't we?
But why would he want to make himself the criminal?
All I can think of is that he's defending somebody else.
Either that, or covering up an even bigger lie, that doesn't change what I need to do at all. Contact HQ about the inconsistencies we've discovered and interrogate the husband again. I'm going to the crime scene. Tell them that, too.
Understood. I'll get authorization immediately.
Try to get a mountain house to investigate here. Let's take a look. Well, that sure is some body tape. Guess we already knew about that, though. There's a clock. Clock with stars.
There's an inscription on this clock. To my loving father and mother from Abby. A gift from a family member? Huh. Why does this decoration look familiar?
Well, apparently that's the same star shape from the bruise on the head. So, the corpse was decked with that clock.
That's right.
I'm forced
to
imagine.
It's the same as that star-shaped bruise on the victim's head. The murderer could have struck the victim with this clock. I need to take this back and carefully investigate it.
I thought the stars were closer together than that, though. Oh well, we've confiscated the clock, I guess. No comment about the apples. Well, I see something down there. Guess no one saw this.
This. It's a shard of glass. What could that be from? Supposedly, only Joseph and the responding police officer were at the murder scene. If that's the case, then...
Well, I guess what's weird is that we're not gonna comment about how no one noticed, but we're gonna comment about how there's no other pieces surrounding it.
Yes, there were no other shards of glass in the area. The police wouldn't be so foolish as to contaminate the crime scene.
How do you know for sure?
I'm beginning to wonder if someone there had cleaned up the other shards of glass. I could send this shard to analysis. We might learn something about it.
Right, what about the fallen over chair? No, I can't comment on that. Alright. We have our handy dandy forensic tool implements. Yes, we do. Alright. Can we find more blood just lying around? Apparently not. What about fingerprints? Nope, I suppose not. What about on this side? Seems like a good place to investigate. It's full of clear stuff. Apparently though, there's nothing. I'll have to leave the scene. We do have at least one more thing that we can send off for.
Hey, little guy, your turn.
Stuff.
Yes, what is it? Oh, you need something analyzed? Just one moment. There's some kind of compound on the concave surface here.
Any details?
It's wine. Yep, no mistake.
So, there's wine on the inside of this piece of curved glass. That means this shard comes from...
Well, the shard doesn't look very opaque, so I would imagine it would be a glass rather than a bottle.
That's probably right. Then again, there could be some oddballs who drink wine straight from the bottle or something.
Perhaps. Let's assume for the moment that it's from a wine glass. A little more investigation may provide us with more information.
You know, it's so weird to drink from the bottle. I think anyone does that ever.
The decoration on the clock matches the victim's head wound, but this couldn't possibly have been the fatal blow. I need to know exactly how this wound would have affected her.
Well, we got rid of that head wound card and fused it with the clock. I don't know if that's gonna be all though. We got broken wine glass, and nothing else. Did I seriously miss something here? Yeah, apparently so. We're gonna comment on the fire pokers, the photos. Hmm. What about the phone? Nothing unusual about the phone. Or the carpet. This picture that we can't see? No, we're not gonna investigate. Plates. Well, the ashes in the fireplace, maybe.
There are traces of something having been burned in this fireplace.
Well, you know, that's usually what happens in fireplaces.
It's something other than firewood. I wonder if there's anything left.
I don't know.
Huh, I've got something. What is this?
Oh boy.
There's something else here, too. Is this fur? What is this doing here?
Well, I guess we needed to find the mysterious fur implement, but now we can return. Well, we got burned hair. Could it be the same hair that was on the clothing?
These two hairs appear to be the same.
Guess we must assume so.
If that's the case, then the hair from the fur was on the victim's clothing. Why, though?
Why, indeed. Well, I'm still not gonna ask about that. Or that. Well, why was the clothes on the fur? Or the fur on the clothes? Kind of surprised that we can just ask the guy to figure out what this is. Mysterious animal hair. They were together. In the ashes. But I guess that's not gonna help outright. Kind of stuck right now. Can't ask about this or this. We've already asked about the wine glass. Oh boy. Oh, we need to analyze the wine glass thing further. And apparently more. What about the clock?
Little guy, could I bother you for a moment?
Anytime. How can I help?
Oh boy.
Well, the wound on the victim's head was caused by a clock found at the scene. I want to know what that wound would have done to the victim.
Okay, I get it. I'll start looking into it right away.
Let me know the moment you get some results.
Ah, Dr. Kimishima, I need to tell you something.
There we go.
Is it good news?
No, bad. Another corpse has been found.
Well, that didn't take long.
I'm already in the middle of investigating a case for you.
Well, the thing is, it might be related to the Alma Parker case.
What do you mean?
A female corpse was discovered in a warehouse at the harbor. The victim is identified as Abigail Parker. She's Alma Parker's daughter.
What?
Yes, it's not just Alma now. Her daughter's been murdered as well.
My God. Is there any connection between the two cases?
We don't know yet, but considering the timing, I'd believe there's a good chance that they're related.
All right, send the corpse over here. I'll perform an autopsy.
Right. I was going to come over and tell you about the clock anyway. I'll load all the information that we've confirmed onto the computer, too.
Huh. A man who comes to visit bringing a dead body as a present. You're the worst guest ever. This kind of thing tends to upset people, you know.
Hey, come on. This is my job.
I'm joking. I'll have a room ready.
Yes, that would be helpful. I'll see you later, then.
Oh, boy. Well, we got corpse number two. In the evidence room.
The daughter of Alma Parker, the first victim, Abigail Parker.
And we're gonna get another phone call from them. It's alright.
These were her last words. I'm not making any promises. But I've heard your words.
Well, let's check the corpse in. see, we got another wound on the hand, but...
There's a deep wound on the chest. This must be the fatal wound.
Also a cross wound on the chest, as before.
Hmm? This stab wound has an odd shape. I've seen this somewhere before.
Giant sigil on the back.
It seems like it was inflicted intentionally.
Doesn't have a bruise though.
I feel like I've seen a similar wound somewhere before.
And that's it for the corpse then. Well, what about this? How about the phone?
Oh, this is the cell phone that Abigail was carrying. It won't turn on. Is it broken?
I don't really see how those keys at the top work, like...
This should be sent in for analysis. It may have some useful information.
I only see one phone symbol. How do you answer? How do you hang up? Stab wound and more hair.
Abigail's hair isn't black. I've seen this black hair before. It's...
It was on her clothes, I'm pretty sure.
That's right. It was animal fur.
From an animal that we have yet to find. And I guess that's it. Well, we can observe a few similarities. We saw the wound.
These murders are too similar for us to dismiss the possibility that they are related.
And apparently it imitates a shiva,
the
bruise.
The wound on the hand wasn't caused by external trauma, while Abigail's wound was obviously made using a sharp tool. At first glance, these may seem to be completely unrelated. However, if we consider any similarities or connections between the two corpses, these wounds may indicate some hidden link that we haven't discovered yet.
And just like that, we lump them together. What about the stab wound for both cases? Abigail, what about the other one? Where is the other one? Well, we've calculated the hairs, I guess.
Just as I thought, these two hairs are identical.
I can tell that just by eyeballing it.
So we know that the hair from the fur found in the fireplace at the murder scene was on both of the two victims. From this, we can deduce that...
They were killed by a monster, but an animal's in the evidence room. Well, apparently the killer wore the fur. I don't know if wearing would be the only...
Indeed. The murderer had been wearing or using the fur somehow.
Yeah, wearing or using. It's not restricted to wearing. Somehow carrying it around. But what if leaving like exactly... five hairs was part of the plan.
Can we tell anything from this wound?
Yeah.
One moment. Let's see. The stab wound in her chest is the same shape as Alma's stab wounds.
Is that so? My hunch was right. This proves...
that the murder weapon is the same, I guess.
Yes. Both murders were committed using the same weapon.
So were they murdered by the same person?
It's likely, but there's no conclusive evidence of that just yet. The wounds aren't exactly the same. There's something very different about them.
So it is, for example.
It's...
the difference was, well, the depth of the wound, I guess.
Yes, the depths aren't the same.
Yeah, the one had an exit wound.
They weren't killed by a machine after all.
I can't rule that out as a possibility either. Still, Alma's stab wound pierces all the way through her body and out her back. Abigail's wound barely reaches her heart. These wounds would require a vast difference in strength to inflict.
I see. Is that so?
In any case, it's dangerous to make more assumptions than is absolutely necessary. Let's continue investigating.
It's alright, we got the same giant Phillips head screwdriver. Well, maybe not, more like a cross-shaped screwdriver for both victims. What about the phone? We should probably have that looked at earlier. Do you need to look into it like gumshoe? Got the two-day-old corpse. still can't ask him about the mysterious ashes. What do we know about the murder weapon now? I guess. Can we collect it out with this? No. Still don't know anything about this internal bleeding. We don't know what could have made that shape. Can't ask about Bruce. Can't ask about the murder weapon or the hair any further. I'm not sure. I feel like I should be able to do something with this card, but I really don't know what. Can we... No, that's not it. Apparently, that feeling was wrong. Seriously, don't get anything new while when we back out and have anything new in the interviews. I don't think there's anything else we can get at the crime scene or from the corpse or effects either, so I guess it's time for elimination.
Alma and her daughter Abigail.
No coincidences.
Corpses share one common thing.
In the stab wound and the animal fur.
That is.
What they had in common was the weapon that killed them, I guess.
Yes. The same weapon was used for both murders. Another similarity can be found among their belongings as well. That is.
They had black animal hair. Under effects.
Yes, both of them had the same type of animal fur on them. There's a very high possibility that these crimes were committed by the same person.
Could have had the same killer, so that still won't let us prove the weapon inconsistency, though.
Dr. Kimishima, a new testimony has arrived.
Good. Whose testimony is it this time?
Let's see. First, we have the person who found Abigail's corpse. He owns a restaurant, but he seems to be an acquaintance of the victim.
Really? How did they know each other?
Well, it seems the victim was an occasional customer at the restaurant. According to the testimony, the victim had visited the restaurant not long ago.
I see. This may be able to help us determine the victim's situation before she was killed. We should confirm when he last saw the victim as well.
Another bit of testimony that needs to be addressed.
Go on.
Well, it's Joseph Parker. He's begun confessing to his daughter's murder as well.
What?
When the questioner asked, he started with the whole identity deal again.
Why did you fools tell him about Abigail?
Well, he is her father, after all. Someone was bound to tell him.
Well, we've lost the chance to learn what really happened from him.
No matter where you go, there's always somebody who has to ruin it for everyone.
Oh well, what's done is done. I'll listen to his testimony too. Send the voice data over.
Understood. Please do so.
Well, I got one more person to interview and one more account to listen to from this guy.
What? Abigail was... Is that true? Yeah. I killed my daughter Abigail too. I'm admitting it. I did it. What more is there to investigate? Cares about the weapons. It doesn't matter. Quit fooling around and give me the death penalty.
Well, he does seem pretty eager. How about Victor Padrini? He's apparently a cook.
Well, when I found the body, I was up that morning fishing for the restaurant's Chef's Catch special. Oh yeah, if you go out a bit, out there, they're quite easy to catch. The market's fish aren't good enough. No, for the fish to be at their freshest, they have to be killed right when they're caught. Well, I was shocked. I never imagined I'd pull up a corpse. And even worse, it was Miss Abby Parker. That's right, I've known the Parkers for years. She'd come to the restaurant with her parents every now and again. Heavens, no, they never fought. They seemed very happy, a wonderful family. The last time Miss Abby came was 3 days ago. No, her parents weren't with her at the time. She was there with a gentleman.
Oh boy, 3 days ago.
Well, the last time...
He says that Abigail was at his restaurant 3 days ago.
And she was there with a gentleman.
So Abigail was still alive at that time.
As much we know. How do we know she died 2 days ago?
Her corpse was found about 2 days since her death. The man who found her body last saw her 3 days ago. That means that when the chef saw her...
It was an hour before death, I don't know.
Yes, it was not long before she was killed. There's a high possibility that Abigail was killed soon after she left his restaurant. It would be best to investigate the man who was seen with her the night she died.
Well, do we even know anything about that person, though?
Oh, Dr. Kimishima, could I bother you for a moment?
If I said no, would you leave me alone?
Oh boy.
No. I definitely think you should hear this.
All right, hurry up.
Thank you. Well, HQ has made a move. The FBI has arrested a suspect for Abigail's murder.
What's going on?
Who knows? Maybe they're jumping the gun. I don't know what the higher-ups are thinking. The man's name is Sean Bowen. He was Abigail's boss where she worked. His wife, Carolyn Bowen, was also taken in for interrogation. They're both at HQ now.
Huh. Is there any evidence that he's the killer?
It seems that this was found at the scene where Abigail had been murdered.
What's this?
It's an expensive lighter from France.
A lighter.
It's a custom order with his name engraved on it.
Sean Bowen. Well, there's no mistaking that.
Well, I could have confused it with something else, maybe.
We also showed Sean's picture to that chef. He confirmed that Sean was the man with Abigail at the restaurant the night she died.
I see. Let me guess. Here's what the FBI thinks happened. Abigail was having an affair with her boss. The situation got complicated, so he killed her.
Bingo, Dr. Kimishima. That's exactly what HQ thinks happened.
What about Alma's murder, then? Would he take the trouble to murder the girl's mother to hide his affair?
Honestly, I don't think they're looking that far ahead. I'd rather believe this than think that Joseph committed either of the murders.
I see. So Joseph is defending the man who killed his own daughter?
Well, now that you mention it, that doesn't make sense at all.
All right. We can't say for certain that this man, Bowen, isn't the murderer just yet. I'm sure he'll be able to tell us what Abigail was doing on that night as well. Can you get the interrogation recordings, little guy?
I've already got them. I know my stuff.
Nice of you to stay on top of things. Send me that data ASAP.
Got it. I'll do that now.
Alright. I got one more person to listen from. What does he have to say?
Good heavens. What's going on? I haven't done anything to get interrogated by people like you, Abby. Yes, she did work for us. She was a very innocent and beautiful girl. You know the type, right? Look, I'm sure you figured it out for yourself, right? What we have is a relationship between two consenting adults. She's the one who asked me to meet her at the restaurant, but she got a phone call and left before the meal came. Where she went? How should I know? She said something came up, but who knows? Huh? That's my lighter. Where did you... The scene of the murder? A warehouse at the harbor? No! I've never been there! I don't even carry that lighter with me. I keep it at home, so what would I be doing there? I get it. This is a trap. Someone's setting me up to be the killer. Listen, that lighter's a custom-made, expensive piece. I keep it carefully locked in a showcase at home. The showcase? It's in my living room at my house. The only keys to the case belong to me and... me and... Don't tell me.
Oh boy.
Why did his testimony end there?
Oh, that's when his lawyer arrived.
And they took measures so he wouldn't say anything self-incriminating, I take it. That's all right, though. I learned something important that I hadn't been expecting.
Huh. You got some useful information from that recording?
You weren't paying attention. If that man is telling the truth, then Abigail's cell phone has an important clue. That is...
Record of calls made or received? Calls received, I guess.
Yes. Upon receiving a call from someone, she abruptly left the restaurant and was killed. It's quite possible that call came from the murderer.
I see.
Even if the caller isn't the killer, we can identify who called her.
Gotcha. I'll make sure they hurry up and analyze the cell phone.
Wait. We also need evidence to back his testimony up as well.
That's true. What can we do about that?
It shouldn't be difficult to get a witness to verify his testimony.
A witness? But who?
Think about it. It would have to be...
The other person would be... The chef? Well, out of all of these, I would think so.
Right. He did remember seeing Sean and Abigail at the restaurant that night. You think he might have more to say about how they were acting then?
Yes. Can you go talk to that chef one more time?
No problem. I'll ask him for more details about that night.
There's also that lighter to consider. It's most likely that it was removed from Bowen's house by...
John would take... Well, I would imagine that it would be the wife, but...
Yes. According to his statement, the lighter was supposed to be in his home. The only person besides him who would have been in a position to take it would be his wife, Carolyn. If we inspect the lighter itself, we may learn something from it.
I see. You'll need the recordings from Carolyn's questioning as well. I'll send it over right now, so please use the recorder to listen to it.
Yes, make sure I get those. I'm counting on you, little guy.
All right. We got one more person to listen to. Enlightening.
She's rather emotional. Is she unstable?
That's just normal, Dr. Kimishima. You're a little too calm.
Well, I have my moments too. Sometimes.
Anyway, Carolyn's insisting that she was home the entire time.
Is there any way to prove that?
No, there aren't any witnesses. She says she was alone the entire time.
Did she know that Sean and Abigail were together that night?
No, we told her that her husband is a suspect in a murder investigation. She shouldn't know that Sean was involved with Abigail. We're trying to keep the details under wraps.
I see. If that's the case, then she knows too much.
Huh. What do you mean?
Let's listen to her testimony one more time. Pay attention.
Peculiar statement.
She called him a cheating bastard.
It's pretty there's more going on than
he
no.
Like a player. I mean,
that could be a
term or more assumptions.
But what if there was another reason?
Like what?
Well, for example,
because she saw him with Abigail.
Yes. What if she had seen Sean and Abigail together?
That would explain her hostility.
If that's the case, then she did witness what happened to the victim that night. This might lead us to something even more important.
I don't have the lighter. Can we look into the lighter?
Something analyzed.
Probably be a good idea.
Is it the lighter that was found at the murder scene?
Yes. I just need you to find any fingerprints on it.
Fingerprints? Just a second. Oh, wait. They're all the same. prints repeated over and over.
Hmm. Can we find out whose they are?
Let's see. These are Carolyn Bowen's.
Bingo. So the one who left this lighter at the scene was...
Well, if she's the other one with her prints on it, then...
Right. Sean's wife, Carolyn, left the lighter at the murder scene.
And we've extended the lighter. Star counter card, I don't know. So, if she was the one who left the lighter there,
Sean's wife left the lighter at the scene of Abigail's killing.
That would implicate her.
Her interrogation suggests that she saw her husband together with the victim. Does this mean that Carolyn is behind both the murders in this investigation?
I can't say for sure.
Even if she had a reason for killing Abigail, she had no motive for Alma's murder. But she may be able to provide us with information regarding Abigail's murder. I need a little more information from her. That's the little guy's job.
I guess we're gonna delegate that.
What's this?
It wasn't Sean who left the lighter at Abigail's murder scene. It was Carolyn. That makes her our most probable suspect now.
Really? I wonder what HQ is going to think when they hear this.
I don't care. I'm not interested in your office politics.
I know that. So, what do you think? Honestly?
I find it most likely that she's not the killer. Still, she may have witnessed something. If she finds herself our main suspect, perhaps that will loosen her tongue a bit.
I see. I'll use this info when I speak to her then.
You're going to talk to her yourself? That's odd.
Well, it takes a liar to catch a liar. I'm good at this kind of thing.
I don't know about that, but...
I'll be counting on you.
Right. Oh, by the way, Abigail's cell phone has been repaired.
Great. Were the records of received calls intact?
She did receive a call during the time we believe she was at the restaurant. However... We've traced the call to a nearby payphone.
Huh, I see. I wonder if this information will lead us anywhere.
We're going to ask around the area if there were any witnesses near the phone, but we don't still there's no doubt that that was the last call made to her cell phone.
I see. So there's a good chance that call came from the murderer after all. Abigail was called out from a public phone, and then she was killed.
We'll continue looking into the deal with the payphone. Oh, we spoke to the chef again, too. Check out the recorder when you have time.
All right, I'll listen to it later.
So she was called from a payphone. Can that be used to determine when she died? Yes.
Abigail's timeline that night until her death. When was she last seen before she died?
At the restaurant. 3.
That's right. She was seen at a restaurant that she was a frequent customer at. The one with her at the time was
Sean Bowen. Apparently, though.
Correct. She was witnessed there with her boss. Afterwards, she left the restaurant alone. The reason she left was...
Because a phone call that apparently lured her away.
Yes. A phone call caused her to leave the restaurant immediately. But where did this call come from?
12?
Indeed. The payphone near the murder scene. It's most likely that the killer called her from the public phone, then waited for the victim to arrive and ambushed her. That would be what happened on Abigail's last night in this world.
Right, I guess we made up a murder timeline. Not that we can do anything else, though. But I guess we must. Evidence about having the same killer, no? Don't know what we could fuse to make that though. Maybe now this card will be good for something. Also, my dog keeps barking and I'm not sure why. I can only imagine that there are noisy people out in the hallway and she's doing a much better job of hearing them than I am. So yeah, it's time for some change in the evidence to review the same killer card. Well, I've never seen anything about the internal bleeding, but okay, that's not it. I tried mixing those, nothing. Okay, those two are useless. I'm afraid I'm very confused. Did I miss any? Oh, there's something else to listen to in this new testimony, I guess.
How'd she act? Let me think. I remember that she was talking on her phone. I clearly remember that she left the restaurant in a hurry soon after that. The man who was with her left in a bad mood afterwards. No, I don't think that he went after Miss Abby. No. He left the restaurant an hour after Miss Abby did. I know that because I served a carafe of wine to the table. The gentleman drank it all himself before he left. I remember being disappointed because they ordered a very fine wine.
There we go.
We've received a recording.
Need to experience everything.
More questioning? Who is it this time?
Carolyn Bowen, Sean's wife. Once they confronted her about the lighter, she started talking.
I see. I'll check it out.
Oh, okay, what does this woman have to say about...
What if my fingerprints were on the lighter?
The murder scene.
To do with... Why am I a suspect? No, I'm telling you it wasn't like that. That skank! I didn't report it because I knew I'd get dragged into this mess. Yes, that's right. I happened to be out that day and saw them dining together. They looked like they were having the time of their lives, and I lost it. I was going to charge in there and slap both of them, and then the skank left the restaurant still on her phone. I followed that slut, but just because I was curious. I didn't want her to get away. Of course I was angry. She went into a warehouse not far from there. I couldn't see too well from where I was hiding, but she didn't come out for a while, so I peeked into the warehouse, and there was this hairy beast. It was on top of her. It was doing something to her hand with its terrible claws. I knew she'd been killed, but I had nothing to do with it. I mean, it serves her right. Did she think she could just steal any man she wanted? That's probably when I dropped the lighter. Of course, I didn't report it. I would have been the very first suspect.
I don't believe it.
I guess.
This is one weird testimony.
So,
our murder investigation suddenly turned into a monster hunt. We've had a sketch artist create a picture from her account, but...
Oh boy.
Are there any animals that size around here?
Well, I don't know.
Don't be ridiculous. It's someone wearing a mask and some kind of costume.
I thought as much. Could the killer be insane?
Could it be the hide behind?
Who can say? There's no way to know anything yet.
Well, we're after a monster now. Can we? Oh, the mysterious ashes.
From the sketch, the murderer was wearing a mask. Now I know what that white shard from the fireplace was.
Do we?
It must have been from the mask that the murderer was wearing while committing the crimes.
I guess. Well, now we know exactly what the mask looks like, based on that one scrap of stuff.
Why would the murderer throw the mask into the fireplace? Whatever the reason, it helps to sort everything out.
Well, how about now? Can we analyze something different? No.
Okay, I need to sort out the information I have on hand.
Alright, here we go.
My main concern right now is the costume worn by whoever killed the two women. How did it end up in the fireplace in the Parker residence, where Alma was murdered? The most logical reason that can be considered at the moment is...
Well... To destroy the evidence?
Yes. Putting it in the fireplace could be an attempt to destroy it. And if that is the case, something strikes me as odd about how Joseph, Alma's husband, was acting. That is...
Well, he was confessing to the murders, but there was still evidence destruction going on.
He confessed to Alma's murder from the very beginning. If he was willing to confess, what reason would he have to hide any evidence? Let's assume for a moment that someone else is the real killer. Can we follow this hypothetical person's steps?
I don't know, can we?
This person would have killed both Alma and Abigail. The first person to be killed would have been...
It would have been Abigail, I would imagine. She died first.
Right. Alma's corpse was found first, but Abigail had been killed before then. In other words, the killer wore a costume to kill Abigail, then killed Alma the next day, after which the costume was discarded into the fireplace. However, we haven't found the murder weapon yet. There were no traces of it in the fireplace. The killer would also have some connection to the two victims as well. We can assume that Abigail personally knew her murderer. The reason for this is...
Because she responded to the phone call.
Right. She received a phone call from a payphone to call her out. The killer knew Abigail's phone number, and Abigail rushed out right after receiving the call. It's unreasonable to think that she would do that for someone she didn't know. Similarly, there's a good chance that Joseph knows the killer as well. This is because...
Joseph also knows a killer because he's lucky to protect them.
Yes. If that wasn't so, Joseph would have no reason to defend whoever killed his wife. So, is the killer someone that the entire Parker family would be acquainted with?
Well, what do we got?
Kimishima, sorry to keep you waiting. We've taken a look at the clock we recovered from the Parker house and...
And?
Oh, hello? Naomi, can you hear me?
Oh boy.
Alyssa? What are you doing there?
Wow, I can hear you. This guy let me in.
Little guy?
His girl said that she really had to talk to you.
Alright. Alyssa, can you hear me?
Yep, I can hear you.
I need to do some work with the man you're with. Be a good girl and be quiet for a little bit.
That
didn't take long. Get to it.
As you mentioned, the decoration on the clock matches the wound on the corpse's head. It probably fell off the desk and struck the victim's head. This may have happened while she was struggling with her assailant.
I see. Is it possible for that wound to have been the cause of death?
No, that's impossible. The impact wouldn't have been enough to kill someone. We've inspected the exterior of the clock, but it doesn't seem that damaged either.
I see. Then...
Then? Oh boy.
Little guy? What's that sound?
Sorry. Looks like this clock is the kind that plays a little tune.
Hey, Naomi?
Alyssa, you said that you'd keep quiet.
I'm sorry, but that clock is broken.
Broken? Where?
I mean, I know how this song goes, but this one part sounds all weird.
Huh? Little guy, has anybody looked inside the clock?
One second.
Well.
What the? Dr. Kimishima, there's something inside.
We may have found just what we're looking for. Thank you, Alyssa.
Thank you, living plot device. There's a giant screwdriver. And we have the big chest card. We don't.
I want to know more about this weapon, little guy.
Oh yeah, no problem. It has an X-shaped cross section, and it's 25 centimeters long. It's thinner at the tip, and it's shaped more like a stake than a knife. This isn't a commercially available weapon. This is just a piece of steel with sharpened edges.
Huh. So the killer made it?
It seems that way. It's a poor cutting implement, but it could certainly be used for stabbing.
I see. This could be the weapon, then.
Alright. Got the weapon's blade and the weapon's hilt, but we're still not gonna see anything about the,
The shape on the end of the weapon's hilt appears to match the bruise on Alma's hand.
The gashes on the chest, but now that we've seen the hilt, detail there. That's apparently what causes the bruise on the palm.
Could be from Alma pushing her hand against the hilt of the weapon. If that's the case, then the person who used this weapon would have to be...
Well, Alma herself. Apparently the victim was also the killer.
Yes. If the weapon is used by thrusting forward while applying pressure with the palm, then the only way Alma could get this bruise is if she was the one wielding the weapon. But what does this mean?
Well, maybe she stabbed it into a wall and pressed against it really hard just because she was bored. Be time to
Yes, if we put these together it should be easier to identify the weapon. The victims, Alma and Abigail, they both died from being stabbed in the chest by a weapon with the same shape. Their wounds match the shape of the weapon found inside the clock.
Alright, they finally figured out what the murder weapon is.
With the same weapon, this handmade stake.
Okay. We can't mix that into anything though. Still doesn't want to analyze that.
Abigail was killed by the stab wound in her chest. The shape of her stab wound perfectly matches the shape of the weapon found in the clock. The bruise on Alma's palm indicates that she had been using the weapon. If Abigail was murdered by Alma, it would make sense for Abigail to respond to a phone call from her mother. There's also Abigail's final words to consider.
Oh, dear
Ryan,
run!
Huh. Why would she say that?
Because she didn't know it was Alma, or because she thought Alma would be present and didn't know the well, same difference.
That's right. The killer was wearing a mask and covered in fur at the time. Even as Abigail lay dying, she had no idea that her killer was her own mother. That's why she called out, to warn her mother away. From the phone call, she would have assumed that her mother, Alma, was somewhere nearby. But if Alma is the murderer, how did she end up killed by the weapon that she had been using?
I mean, it's not impossible.
Dr. Kimishima, the results of our analysis have come in.
It's hardly unheard of.
Good. Which analysis was this?
The wine glass. Something else was detected in the residue.
Well,
what is it?
We've detected traces of benzodiazepine in the wine.
Benzodiazepine? Isn't that used in sleeping pills and anti-anxiety medication?
That's right. It seems to have been mixed in with the wine.
Hmm. Little guy, was there any benzodiazepine found in Alma's body?
No, why? The results of the drug test came up with a negative on that.
That's all right. I just wanted to make sure that she wasn't the one taking it.
Okay.
Oh. So there was some knockout drug in the wine that Alma didn't drink.
If we believe that Alma is the one that killed Abigail, then Alma put the sleeping medication into the wine. The one who drank it was...
Well, that would have been Joseph, I guess.
Yes. Her husband, Joseph.
What do you mean? Are you saying?
That's right. Alma tried to kill Joseph as well.
Well?
Dr. Kimishima, isn't that just...
The weapon left a bruise on her palm. That is proof that she used the weapon.
But she was killed by that same weapon.
That's true. Let's stay calm and think this through. We have evidence that there was a struggle between Joseph and Alma, don't we? That is...
The evidence would be... The bruise? Blood on the sleeve? I would imagine. Out of all of those...
The blood stains are quite likely from... when Joseph was injured and grabbed Alma's wrist during the struggle.
Then, did Joseph kill Alma during that fight?
I'm just saying that this is one conjecture we could make.
But there's no motive. The family reportedly got along well.
Little guy, where is Mr. Parker right now?
Huh? He's still being detained.
Good. Tell him something. Tell him we found the weapon Mrs. Parker was using inside the clock.
All right, I'll do that. Where are you going, Dr. Kimishima?
I'm going back to the murder scene. I want to find Alma's motive.
I guess we are. How are we going to do that, though?
Can I bother you for a moment?
What's the matter?
HQ contacted me just a moment ago. It seems Joseph Parker has a message for you.
The victim's husband? But why?
I don't know. I'll send the recording over to you right now.
This message is for whoever is investigating my case.